Myself, Hariwa Prasad Damarla, a retired Deputy General Manager from BSNL and ex-Senior Project Manager, AP State Fiber Limited and ex-Adjunct Professor, EC Department, PSCMR College of Engineering and Technology, Vijayawada, AP. In this session, we will try to understand about the charging plan in telecom networks. The charging plan refers to how the subscribers are charged by their telecom service providers, TSPs. They have to take certain The TSPs have to take certain factors into consideration while fixing charges for different services they offer to their customers. The charges that are payable for local calls, the charges that are payable for trunk calls, the charges that are payable for STD, ISD, lease circuits, all these aspects we will try to understand in this session. Let us go through the introduction about charging plan. Providing telecom services calls for lot of investment in terms of capital costs as well as operational expenditure. The telecom service provider has to invest huge amount towards capital costs as well as operational costs. Then we will look into the capital costs as well as the operational costs. The capital cost includes the cost towards line plant, the cost towards switching systems, the cost of land and buildings. So these sub items comes under capital investment or capital cost. Then operating costs include staff salaries, what they have to pay to their officials, and day-to-day maintenance costs, water and electricity charges or bills, and some miscellaneous expenses. These fall under operating costs. So naturally, the TSP, that is the telecom service provider, has to get back this money from their customers or subscribers in terms of the charges for various services they are offering. A telecom administration receives its income from its subscribers. That what we have told. A charging plan provides for recovering both the capital costs and operational costs from their subscribers. So they have to realize the capital costs as well as the operational costs from the subscribers to whom they are providing the services. The cost of shared resources like switching equipment is amortized among a large number of subscribers over a period of time. Then, as far as the shared costs our resources are concerned, for example, the switching equipment, for which they have to spend a lot of money in purchasing, installation, commissioning, and putting into service. So these shared resources are amortized among large number of subscribers. That means they are distributed among all the subscribers served by that telephone exchange. Maybe some 5,000 or 10,000. In a smaller place, it may be 200 to 1,000 subscribers also. And that too over a period. The period may be 5 to 10 years. So they have to realize the shared resources from their subscribers served by that exchange over a time period of say 5 to 10 years. In this slide, we will look into the charging plan and types of charges. The cost of dedicated resources like the telephone instrument and the subscriber line must be recovered from the individual customers. Whenever you are provided with a telephone connection, you should be provided with an instrument, maybe in your office or residence, wherever you are taking the service. And the TSP has to extend one copper pair right from the telephone exchange to the user. So they are known as dedicated resources. These resources are dedicated to a customer who is taking the service, individual customer. So these dedicated resources or expenses are to be recorded from the respective or individual customers to whom they give the connection. The operating costs must be worked out depending upon the quantum of resources used in providing a service and the duration for which these resources are used. Then, as far as the operating costs are concerned, it depends upon the quantum of resources used in providing a service and the duration for which these resources are utilized by the subscriber. Taking all these factors into consideration, a charging plan for a telecom service levies 3 different charges on a subscriber. So, in the charging plan for a telecom service, they levy 3 types of charges on their subscriber. What are these 3 types? We will look into the slide. An initial charge for providing a network connection. So whenever they are providing the telephone connection to their subscriber, some initial charge, it is also popularly known as installation charge, would be collected from the respective subscriber. A rental or lease charge. So for providing the service connection, so they collect monthly or bi-monthly or quarterly rental charges or the lease charge for providing you telephone service. It is independent whether you utilize the service or not, because a service is connection is provided to you. So this is up to you whether to utilize the telephone or not. But this rental is to be paid on monthly, bi-monthly, or quarterly, whatever the way, as per the policy of the TSP and as per the tariff chosen by the subscriber. Charges for individual calls made. Apart from these two, the initial charge and rental, so whenever they make calls, maybe local or trunk call or STD, whatever it is, for those calls also, they have to pay the charges. Further, we will continue our discussion. A subscriber share of the capital costs of common resources is generally recovered in the initial connection charge and in the rental components. So, whatever the share a particular subscriber has to pay under capital costs of common resources, so generally they are recovered in the initial connection charge at the time of providing the connection and in rental also. That is monthly or bi-monthly, quarterly, whatever it is applicable. The rental may be levied on a monthly or bi-monthly, quarterly, half-yearly, annual basis. So rental is to be paid like this. Monthly basis, bi-monthly basis, quarterly, half-yearly, annually. Of course, nowadays, for 2 months, 3 months, 2 years, 3 years also, some fixed charges are there, rentals in the form of rentals. Certain operating costs are incurred even if the network carries no traffic and these are covered by the rental. So the operational costs which are to be incurred by the TSP, even if the network carries no traffic. That means the telephone exchange should be live, on, always on 24/7. So for that, it needs a power supply and air conditioning and the staff to man the exchange. Whether the customers are making or utilizing the telephone exchange for their calls or not. So that is to be that portion of operating costs are to be recovered in the form of rentals. That is in the form of lease. Charges for individual calls include the operating costs in establishing and maintaining the calls and a component for the capital resources used. So the individual calls are charged, taking into consideration the operating costs in establishing and maintaining the calls. That is one portion, and the other component is capital resources that are used for the specific call. In practice, exact apportionment of costs to different heads is rather difficult. So this is general policy what we have discussed, but exact apportionment of cost is difficult to arrive at. There are also other factors like marketing policies and bar trends and the government regulations. The charges that are payable by the subscribers for different services depends upon not only the operating costs and capital resources, it also depends on the factors like marketing trends, policies, and government also stipulates certain regulations. So in our subsequent discussion, we can understand what are all the regulations in the sense. So the local costs should be subsidized through trunk calls. Let us look into the next slide. Charging policy and the methods. For example, often government regulations demand that revenue from a trunk call, trunk network, be used to subsidize the cost of the local networks or local calls. So the local call should be given at a cheaper rate. So the telecom service provider has to take into consideration about this fact while charging the trunk calls. So the trunk calls are costlier when compared to local calls, because as per the government regulations, so for local calls, so minimum amount is to be charged as against the trunk calls. The technical developments in trunk transmission, that is in long distance network or inter-exchange communication, has resulted in significant cost reductions in trunk networks. So the technical developments have led to the reduction in the cost in trunk networks for trunk calls, whereas the local network services still continue to be expensive. So local network services or the local calls are expensive, but they are subsidized through trunk calls. By feeding revenue from one service to another, the subscribers are given reasonable tariff structures both for local and long distance services. So by feeding the revenue from one service to other service, so they try to, the TSPs try to provide reasonable tariff structures both for local and trunk calls. Charging for individual calls is accounted for by using either a metering instrument connected to each subscriber line or a metering register assigned to each subscriber in case of electronic exchanges. Then how they will be charged individual calls? So they will be using the meter, that is metering instrument connected to each and every subscriber. Whenever he makes a call, the meter is incremented. Just like in electricity, the number of units consumed like that. Here also in terms of units only. In case of electronic exchanges, nowadays we say metering register is assigned to each and every subscriber. Let's continue our discussion. Here we will further look into the charging plan and metering methods. We use the term meter to denote the instrument or the register. Okay, in electronic exchange, it is register. Of course, nowadays it is register. Old name is instrument, meter, instrument. The count in the meter represents the number of charging units. So depending upon the feeding in the meter, so the charging units are arrived at for charging. A bill is raised by assigning a rate to the charging unit. Each charging unit, they will assign some rate, maybe some 2 rupees per unit or 1 rupee per unit. Of course, nowadays the rates have come down, but let us assume each unit they will charge 1 rupee. Unit may be 1 minute. Earlier it used to be 3 minutes for local call. The count is incremented by sending a pulse to the meter. Depending upon the time, one pulse is sent. Charging methods for individual calls falls under two broad categories. So what are the categories of charging methods? There are two methods, categories. Duration independent charging. Duration independent charging. That is irrespective of the duration. So charges are fixed. That is one type. The other one is duration dependent charging. Depending upon the duration for which you are speaking or making the call, maybe STD, ISD. Accordingly, you will be charged, even in case of local calls also. Suppose if you are speaking for 5 minutes, depend, say each minute, let us assume 1 unit. So 5 units, you should be charged. Local calls within a numbering area are usually charged on a duration independent basis. Local calls in the same numbering area or in the same town, they are charged on a duration independent basis. But I have put a question mark. This may be in vogue in olden days. Nowadays it is not so. It is dependent on the duration only. The charging meter is incremented once for every successful call. That is, whenever the called party answers, the charging meter is incremented once for every successful call. When it is considered as successful call, that is, whenever the called party answers. You have given a ring to the called party, to your friend. So the charging commences, the duration commences after the called party, after your friend lifts the telephone only, it will be charged. Let us continue our discussion. Charging plan and tariff methods. In the olden days, when STD and ISD facilities were not available, the trunk calls were established with the help of operators who were also responsible for the call charging. Therefore, the subscriber meters were then useful only for local calls. So in olden days, in the initial stages of evolution and development of telecom networks, so all the outstation calls like STD or ISD, they were not available. So they are to be provided in the form of trunk calls by the telephone operators. So therefore, it is the responsibility of the telephone operator at that time to take care of call charging. So they have to monitor for the duration for which the subscriber has spoken with the called party. Based on the duration, he has to see how many minutes he has spoken, and subsequently based on the duration and the station, so the calls were charged. Therefore, the subscriber meters were then useful only for local calls. At that time, in the olden days, when operators were providing the trunk calls, so the meters which are provided against each and every subscriber, they are useful only for local calls. To avoid the capital cost of providing meters and operating costs of reading meters at regular intervals and preparing the bills, some administrations have adopted a flat rate tariff system where some fixed charges for an estimated average number of local calls are included in the rental. So if meters are provided, so then the meters readings are to be taken in those days manually. So it involves the operating costs in terms of providing meters, capital costs for providing meters, and operating costs for reading the meters, and recording in a register, and then billing. So it involves some expenditure, both in terms of capital costs and operational costs. So to avoid that, some telecom service providers in those days, they have adopted a flat rate system. Irrespective of the number of the calls they are making, so they used to fix each subscriber, they have to pay this monthly charge, something like that. So if that is the case, the person who is making more calls will have the benefits of using the telecom network. The person who rarely makes calls will have the disadvantage. So that was the scenario. This scheme is advantageous. That is flat rate tariff system, fixed monthly charge or bi-monthly charge, whatever you call it, irrespective of the number of the calls and the duration for which they are speaking. That is flat rate tariff system. This scheme is advantageous to subscribers who make large number of calls. So this flat rate system is advantageous in case who is making large number of calls, but unfair to sparing users. So it is not fair as far as the sparing user is concerned. Business subscribers are charged at a higher flat rate than compared to domestic subscribers. So there used to be two categories, that is home or domestic user or the business establishment or the subscriber. So normally for business people, they used to charge more. For domestic users, they used to charge less. Then in this slide, we will look into tariff methods. When flat rate charging is used, the subscribers naturally tend to make more calls. So in case of flat rate, it is fixed every month 200 rupees. That means they try to make more calls, whether required or not. Just for chit-chatting also, they make calls. This necessitates local exchanges to be designed for a higher traffic level. So therefore, the telecom service provider, while fixing the flat rate charging, has to take into consideration about the design of the local exchange. He has to ensure that even for more number of calls, the system should sustain even in the busy hour. So that factor is to be taken into consideration. That is the negative aspect. They have to provide more switching capability for their telephone exchanges, which may be costly. Some administrations combine the features of flat rate and call rate charging. So some they adopted the features of flat rate and call charging. Up to say some 100 calls, it is fixed. Whether you make 0 calls or 100 calls, this much amount you have to pay. Beyond that 100 calls, you have to pay as per the number of the calls and the duration. The rental covers certain number of free calls per rental period, and only calls above this number are charged. And India uses this scheme. So in the rental, they say, for example, every month, so free calls to an extent of 100 are given, 100 units are given. Beyond that, you have to pay per unit this much amount. So up to 100 calls, say, for example, they will charge 150 rupees per month. So that is the rental. fixed charge up to 100 units. So it covers under rental, that 150 rupees only. Beyond that, if anybody is speaking, that will be separately charged. So total number of calls they will give and what is the calls covered under rental, they will deduct, and the balance units they will arrive at, and as per the charging policy, they will charge for the balance calls. So as given here, in India, we are adopting this procedure. This and all we are more discussing related to landline communication. Let us not confuse with the present scenario of mobile communication. We are discussing the concept of charging and its evolution as far as the landline is concerned. It may be noted that this scheme offers no specific advantage in terms of reducing the capital or operating costs. So this is not beneficial, this concept, for telecom service provider, because it does not reduce the capital or operating costs. This is another aspect from telecom service provider is concerned. With the introduction of STD and ISD, automatic charging demands that subscriber meters be installed. So with the introduction of STD and ISD, it became a must that each and every subscriber should be provided with a meter to charge their calls, to count their calls, to count the number of units for which they are speaking. Moreover, with the advent of data transmission, local calls tend to be longer duration. Subsequently, they have superimposed these data calls over the switching network, telephone lines. So they generally last for longer duration. So therefore, meters is a must in view of not only STD bar ISD, but also in view of data communication. Due to these reasons, flat rate charging is likely to be discarded soon. Of course, it is the older information. Now, as far as India or all the countries, I can say they have already dispensed with this fixed or flat rate charging methods. Here, this note you can see already discarded in India. So flat rate charging is discarded. It is no more in vogue. Further, we will continue on charging plan. In the case of duration dependent charging, a periodic train of pulses from a common pulse generator operates the calling subscriber's meter at appropriate intervals. So the pulse generator sends a pulse periodically. So let us assume the local calls are charged for every 3 minutes, one unit, let us assume. So somebody speaks, say, for example, some 16 minutes. So every 3 minutes, so the meter is to be incremented by one unit. 16 means 15 plus 1. Okay, up to 18 minutes. So 6 units are chargeable because he has spoken for only 16 minutes. So first 15 minutes, so 5 units, and the next 1 minute, another 1 unit. So he has to pay for 6 units. This method is called periodic pulse metering. This procedure is known as periodic pulse metering. Every 3 minutes, in our example, whatever we have considered, one pulse is to be sent to the meter for incrementing the meter reading. Okay. In this case, the charge for a call is proportional to its duration. In this pulse metering scenario, the charges for the call is proportional to its duration. Already we have seen one example. The traffic carried by a telecom network varies throughout the day. So the traffic carried by telephone network is not fixed. It may be more during office hours. It may be less during small hours. That is, after night 12 o'clock or 11 o'clock, up to morning, say 7 or 8, number of calls may be less. So therefore, the traffic depends upon the time of the day. It is not uniform for the entire 24 hours in a day. The quantum of switching equipment and the junction plant provided in the network is based on the busy hour traffic. So the switching equipment, what is the switching equipment required or the junction plant required, depends upon the busy hour traffic. Why busy hour traffic is to be taken into consideration? Even in busy hour also, calls should not fail. We have also discussed about the grade of service, how many calls can fail in busiest hour, and all we have discussed. So the TSP has to ensure that even in busy hour, call should not fail for want of switching equipment or the junction plant. Therefore, a large part of this hardware remains idle during off-peak hours. Since we are providing the equipment, taking the busy hour traffic into consideration, so in non-busy hours, that is in the late night hours or in the early morning, so the hardware, the switching equipment remains idle. So this aspect we will take into consideration for fixing charges, less charges during off-peak periods to encourage the subscribers to make use of the network so that the equipment will not be completely idle during off-peak hours as far as the TSP is concerned, and they will get some reasonable revenue during the off-peak period also. In order to restrict the peak demand and encourage off-peak demand, it is common to make the metering rate vary with the time of the day. Just now I have explained. So depending upon the day, say for example, in the peak period, say every 3 minutes, one local call is charged. In the off-peak time, say, let us assume from midnight 12 o'clock to morning 6. So rarely subscribers, they make calls. So at that time, if anybody is making call, some rebate is given in the form of, say, for example, for 6 minutes, one call. So this encourages some people to make calls, cheap calls at cheaper rate during off-peak period. This is done by suitably changing the pulse repetition frequency under the control of a time of the day clock, based on the clock. So the pulse repetition frequency, in our example, instead of 3 minutes, so let us say some 5 minutes or 6 minutes, one pulse can be given. Accordingly, the pulse repetition frequency is to be automatically adjusted depending upon the clock of the telephone exchange. Trunk calls are almost invariably charged on a duration dependent basis. Trunk calls generally they are charged based on the duration, but as a matter of fact, with my practical experience, I can say for trunk calls also, some off-peak time they are charged at discounted rates. In addition, the charges are also depend on the radial distance between the calling and the call stations. That is, the trunk call charging is based on the distance time products. So the trunk call charges depends upon the distance from the calling station to call station. It is distance dependent, not only time dependent, it is also distance dependent. Say, for example, from Vijayawada, I am making a call to Hyderabad. So its distance is something like around, say, for example, some 300 kilometers. Suppose if I make a call to Bombay, let us assume it is some 700 minutes difference to Vijayawada. So both Hyderabad and Bombay calls cannot be charged at the same rate. So it depends upon the distance because it utilizes more network, more distance network for Bombay call with reference to Hyderabad call. So therefore, the trunk call charging is based on the distance and time products. So it depends upon the distance as well as the time. So we will say, in general, we will say a distance time product. When the trunk call is established through an operator, this I have shown in operator everywhere, I have shown in the red in the sense it is not in vogue at present. It was there few years back. Few years means some 15-20 years back. Nowadays, no operator. So everybody is dialing, whether it is local or STD or ISD or call to mobile network anywhere in the world. Okay. For understanding the concept, let us take all these factors into consideration. When the trunk call is established to an operator, certain minimum charges are levied to cover up the labor cost. So, operator so involves a manual activity. So, operator's salaries are to be paid. So, while charging, so they fix some minimum charge to cover the labor cost. Whether you speak for 1 minute, you speak for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. So some minimum charge will be there to take care of the labor cost towards the operator expenditure, telephone operator expenditure. A typical tariff is based on a minimum charge up to 3 minutes. This is some example. A typical tariff is based on a minimum charge up to 3 minutes, together with a charge of less than a third for every additional minute. One specific example here he has given. Let us assume that you have made a trunk call with the help of operator. Of course, that is in olden days. So the charge for 3 minutes, the minimum charge is fixed. Okay, let us assume the minimum charge for 3 minutes is say 10 rupees to Delhi, from Vijayawada to Delhi, 10 rupees. So whether you speak for 1 minute, half minute, or 2.5 minutes, or just up to 3 minutes, so you'll be charged 10 rupees. So suppose if you have spoken for 5 minutes, so then you should be charged on prorata basis. Say if you take that example, 3 minutes, 10 rupees, and each minute works out to 3 rupees, 33 paise. So for extra 2 minutes, in case of 5 minutes call, 2 into 3 rupees, 33 paise will not be charged. So it will be beyond 3 minutes. It is not proportional. It may be, say, for example, instead of 3 rupees, 33 paise in our example, whatever I have told. So it may be every minute, extra every minute may cost, say, for example, 2 rupees. That means 10 rupees for 3 minutes, another 4 rupees for balance 2 minutes in case of a 5 minutes call. This is another concept and one example. When direct distance dialing, DDD or STD, subscriber trunk dialing facility is used to establish a long distance call, charging is usually accounted for by pulsing the meter at an appropriate rate. So when the STD was introduced, so charging was accounted for by pulsing the meter at an appropriate rate, at an appropriate frequency. The frequency also depends upon the distance from the calling party to the called party. Depending upon the time of the day and the distance involved between the stations, the meter pulse frequency varies. The frequency of the pulse, metering pulse, varies based on two factors: time of the day, whether peak time or off peak time, and the distance also. More the distance, more the time. If it is in peak period, it is more. It is in off peak time, it is less. These are the general concepts of charging plan. But however, finally depends upon the competition in the market, as we are seeing in the mobile as far as Indian scenario is concerned or anywhere in the world. Now, having seen the ISD depends. So ISD also charges similar to STD. In STD, how they are charging, it depends upon the time of the day, number one. Number two, the distance. So let us see ISD case. In case of ISD, that is International Subscriber Dialing, a call charging is carried out by the same method as STD. Here also, it depends upon the time of the day as well as the distance. If you are speaking to the in our neighboring country, the charge may be less. If you are speaking to US, it may be something else. If you are speaking to UK, the unit rate may be different. So, because the distance varies, apart from the time, it also varies depending upon the distance between the calling and called party. However, pulse metering may encounter two difficulties. So as far as the pulse metering is concerned, so there are difficulties. So here he says there are two difficulties. What are these two difficulties? We will try to understand. In pulse metering, first, on the longest and most expensive international calls, the pulse is often more than 1 per second, and therefore a sluggish electromechanical meter may fail to operate. In case of the longest and most expensive international calls, the pulse rate may be less than 1 second. That means even in 1 second, the meter, suppose if the pulse rate is 30 seconds, So within 1 minute, the meter is to be incremented twice. If it is 15 seconds, four times. So the electromechanical meter in olden days, before the introduction of electronic resistors or electronic systems, so they used to fail to properly account for the calls and units. So they are sluggish to operation. They are not fast. They are not electronic meters to operate very fast as we require. So that is one negative aspect as far as the pulse metering of non-electronic, that is electromechanical meter, is concerned. The second aspect, difficulty in case of pulse metering of electromechanical meter is concerned. Here it is given. The second difficulty is most of the electromechanical meters have 4-digit capacity and a heavy user incur more than 9,999 units of charge in the interval between meter readings and thus fail to be charged correctly. Hence, it is necessary to equip such subscriber lines with 5-digit meters. So let us assume one subscriber heavily uses telephone for making STD and ISD calls. So let us assume he is having an electromechanical meter with 4-digit capacity. So total number of units it can charge, show in its meter is 4 9s 9999. Beyond that, it will have some difficulty because it does not have the 5th digit. Suppose if anybody is making calls more than 9,999 units, so there is a difficulty in case of pulse meter with 4-digit capacity only. Then invariably you have to go for 5-digit meters only. Of course, this was the issue with electromechanical pulse metering, not with the present day electronic resistors. For international connections, it is necessary to associate call metering with incoming and outgoing international circuits in addition to subscriber lines. So in case of international connections, so we have to associate the call meter with incoming and outgoing international circuits also, because the revenues to be shared between the two countries from the calling party country and called party country, apart from subscriber lines. So this is specific for international calls. Then we will see another scenario, charging plan in case of coin connection box. Most of you would have seen, still here and there, they are prominently available. So whenever you go to some places like railway station, bus stand, or some other marketing place, so by inserting coin, you can speak. That is called coin collection box. So nowadays, everybody is having mobile. So their usage has come down drastically. A few years back, this CCB concept was very, very popular. They are extensively used by the subscribers who do not own their own telephone instruments. Public telephone booths use coin-operated boxes and also called coin collection boxes, and they are of two types. CCBs are of two types. prepayment type and post-payment type. So you have to pay in advance and make call. That is prepayment type. And post-payment type, you make call, the called party answers, then you have to insert your call. Then only you can talk. Up to making call, you need not insert the coin. A user inserts coins before dialing in prepayment type, and in the later, that is in post-payment type, the user inserts coins after the called party answers. So prepayment means you insert the coin and then dial the number you are intending to speak. But in case of post-payment, you dial the number, called party number, without inserting coin. After the called party answers, you have to insert the appropriate coin, generally 1 rupee coin. In these two cases, special signaling provisions are required between the exchange and the coin collection box. So in CCB case, so we should have a technical special signaling provisions between the exchange and coin box, because its operation is slightly different from the normal subscriber and telephone instrument. These include refund signal in case of the pre-payment coin boxes and open coin slot signal for post-payment type coin boxes. Suppose in prepayment, what you are doing, you are inserting the coin and you are making or dialing the number required for you. Suppose that number is busy. So the coin should come back. So that is refund. That means the coin should come back to you. It has to fall into a slot from where you can take back your coin. So in post-payment type, that is open coin. So suppose the number is engaged, so you need not insert the coin. So that is open coin slot. So these two types of signals are required. Special signals are required in case of CCBs. That is what we have to understand for call charging. Then we will see another scenario, how the charging is done in case of leased line. Leased line means if you consider an establishment, one company. So let us assume there is a company at Bombay with its headquarters at Bombay, and branches spread over across, say for example, in different state headquarters. So they have a lot of requirement of calling from branches to head office or head office to branches. So at that time, they take special lines. They are called non-exchange lines, or they are also called lease lines. They take, say, Bombay head office, they will take one line, exchange line, say from Bombay to Hyderabad, Bombay to Calcutta, Bombay to Chennai, Bombay to Delhi, and Bombay to, say, Jaipur, Ahmedabad, like that, for all important places they will take. So this is the concept of leased line. Let us go through the contents in the slide. For subscribers having heavy point-to-point traffic, as I told you, dedicated or leased lines may be more economical than STD lines. Instead of using STD lines, so for heavy users having heavy point-to-point traffic, it is better to have dedicated exclusive lines via the telecom service provider. Telecom service provider will provide point to point dedicated line between their headquarters and their branch offices in our example. Such non-exchange lines are provided by the telecom administrations on round-the-clock basis. So these lines, once provided, they are mostly available round-the-clock basis. Some organizations, they take lease lines in a specific time also. Nowadays, that provision also is available, but generally they take round-the-clock basis. These non-exchange lines are known as lease lines. These type of non-exchange lines, that is, which are not normal subscriber lines or which are directly connected point to point, are known as lease lines. In case of lease lines, charging is based on the distances involved. So here the charging is based on the distance involved. They don't bother about the duration. Exclusively, they will be given one line. Say, for example, Bombay to Hyderabad, Bombay to Calcutta, Bombay to Chennai, Bombay to Delhi, like that. So whenever they require, they use it. If they don't require, it will be idle. But the charge from Bombay to Calcutta, the charge from Bombay to Chennai or Bombay to Hyderabad, Bombay to Delhi may not be equal for the non-exchange line or the leased line provided by the telecom service provider, because the distance varies. As the user traffic increases, there occurs a break-even point beyond which the lease line becomes more economical for the user. If they have more traffic for lease lines, they are very much economical and compared to STD. If they have lean traffic, they don't require that much. If they take lease lines, it may be costly with reference to normal STD calls. So therefore, the subscribers who have heavy traffic between their main offices and branches, so generally they take lease lines. Nowadays, the lease line revenue is a major component for telecom service firewall, because nowadays banking, insurance sectors, all government organizations, they are all connected by lease lines. Say State Bank of India, you take for example, they may be having say more than some 25,000 or 30,000 branches all over India. So they are all connected in different methods for their internet banking, net banking, and all these things. So for them, the lease lines are economical because they have huge traffic. Let us sum up what we have discussed. We have discussed the concept of charging plan. That is, charging plan mainly depends upon the capital costs and operational costs. Then we have seen how local calls are charged, how trunk calls are charged, how STD calls are charged, and how ISD calls are charged, and the procedure adopted for lease lines. We also understood the meaning of lease line and how they are charged. So, as I told, the lease lines are charged purely based on the distance involved. Of course, nowadays we have to use the term not only distance and also the bandwidth, how much they have taken. Anyhow, that is the beyond the purview of this lecture. So I thank you for participating in this session. So if you like my video, please encourage me with a like and also subscribe to my channel here. youtube.com/c/Halwa Prasad Damarla. Thank you.